reason that they bought media empires. That's no surprise, but the level of their involvement and the level to which the journalists have picked this holy mission of protecting their leader is pretty interesting, even by general media standards, which are low.
The type of pressures that you've just talked about, were they isolated cases that made you leave, or were they something regular in different news offices?
Well, the peculiar thing was that we found it to be not cool and left. It's happening all the time, and if you ask most of our colleagues in the press, it's just how things are done, and you can't do anything about it. And if you want to do some good stuff, so if you want to do an investigation, if you want to do a good report, you have to do also these things, and you have to respect these limits, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to write anywhere, so you wouldn't do any good at all. And another guy would come, and he would be even more corrupt than you, when you supposedly are you, this Romanian journalist, like to think of yourself as a good guy, or at least a better guy than the next.
What made me leave Romania Liberă was that actually none of my colleagues cared that this was going on. And I was like, how can we work here if we don't care about these things going on?
So
I felt alone, left alone. In the newsroom.
Is there, I know that you work with a lot of networks, including the Romanian Center for Investigative Journalism. Were you supported at all by the networks or when you left, or did you find them on your way out?
We worked with NGOs for Freedom of the Press, with these investigative centers, we were connected. So that was, I think that was something that gave us a little courage. That we could go on and we wouldn't be alone and we would be supported in a way. But when we started this, nobody said that, you know, that's independent journalism is a thing that you can do. It was just unthinkable at that moment, both by our colleagues, our parents, our friends, everyone said it cannot be done and that we are stupid even to try.
And it seemed impossible until we actually started doing it.
At which point they came and told us that we aren't doing enough and we should. So that's just how things go.
Before we move on into the new stage of your professional experience, I was just wondering how you felt while you were still back in the traditional news office, being ordered certain articles from your editors. How that made you feel about your status as a journalist overall and about the profession in itself?
Well, first of all, when I got into a newsroom, I had no expectation of good things happening. I just wanted to see how it works.
Sure.
So I really was kind of bulletproof from an emotional standpoint. I didn't feel anything about it. I just felt that it came a bit late. I was expecting it earlier. But maybe Ștefan, he has a bigger heart than me.
I was really frustrated. Actually, I thought about quitting for almost 2 months, I think. I had interminable talks with friends and family of what's next, how can we do something. I didn't want to leave journalism, I just needed something else to do, like journalism, real journalism. It was very frustrating. And then I just thought I should actually give up journalism because I couldn't see any future. But when I went there, the project was like this new online platform, whatever, they wanted to reform their editorial stuff and very nice plans and money infusion and gear and stuff, and you could come up with your own projects and be supported by the editors and stuff. But it only lasted 2 weeks maybe. So then they just said, okay, you have to make three stories a day and one feature per week, and then each day after the program, after your actual work in the office, you had to go home and be this comment moderator and upload some news from the wire, whatever. So it was actually being a slave for this corporation. And I didn't have any time to do real journalism, like writing a story or doing a proper interview.
Was it a case that you would go and pitch a story to your editor and your editor would turn it down?
Usually not. They were very open because, I mean, my editor was not experienced at all in journalism. He was like this... what was his background? Something IT guy, with an IT column in one of the magazines from this media holding. So somehow he got in this position of being the editor of the online department. So he was very open to any suggestion, but of course there was no time. I mean, he said, yeah, of course, you have until 5 o'clock.
That's
it was 3 o'clock or 2 o'clock. Thank you for your support.
Right, so I think what's not clear, at least now, is how does this political pressure creep into news offices, which lands on your back at some point?
Well, the first step is getting the journalist in a position similar to a corporate slave, or just like a factory worker, put him in a position that he has no say in his work, and he should just do whatever the boss says or whatever the head of the media company says. And actually, we were told this in the in journalism school, that the journalist is an information, kind of like an information factory worker. That was. The expression.
That's the attitude.
Yeah, it was an actual expression that the dean of the faculty used.
Yes.
Like an information bureaucratic worker. And you should always listen to your chief. That was the main
IT
thing.
Guy, I mean. Right?
the chief, whoever he might be. So in this context, when these pressures came, they didn't come as this breach of ethics, or as this horrible thing that they're imposing on you. It came as the sixth story that you were ordered to do that day, with a specific angle, and you just did it mechanically without even thinking about it. So at that point, you're not even conscious that you are real in the system of media gagging and controlling.
What is the position of the journalists in the Romanian society? No, you've talked before about having a precarious position as seen by a very average man on the street.
We had several occasions in which we almost got beat up, thanks to our esteemed colleagues in the press, because all the country knows that the journalists are these corrupted wise guys that come to steal your soul and steal it for money. They know that all the media is being controlled politically. Everyone asks us when we try to do a story, and we ask for an interview. They ask us who sent you, and who are you with.
This and is how they decide whether they decided to talk to you or not. Right?
Yeah. Who sent you? And that's a legitimate question, because if we say that guy sent us, he's gonna talk to us. If you say the other guy sent us, he's not gonna talk to us. The other guy being one political party or the other, with these media affiliates that we call the news televisions. And So we have a very hostile environment, but also we have a very fearful environment because the Romanian audience has this mixture of fear and they're disgusted by the media, but they also kind of fear you as a power player in this social landscape. So it's very complicated. You have to, if you have a big story in which you have to work with a source for a long time, we have to do some really hardcore education, media education with the source, so that they can understand what exactly is the job that we are doing. Because when you say journalist in Romania, people don't understand journalist. They understand political worker or bloodthirsty sensationalist tabloid. Mm-hmm.
Laundry washing, in other words. Okay. Now, Ștefan, you've worked for different media. I think you worked for TV, radio, print.
Yeah.
Is this pressure felt differently at various different media?
Well, when I was working in radio, it was a totally different environment. It was a private company as well, but very well established news-wise, so they had a pretty good newsroom. Well, of course, I didn't get to do much stories either, because when I started working in the media, it was 2009, so Romanian media was going down.
Post-financial crisis,
yeah.
Right?
So salary cuts and people losing their jobs, so I started working on, like, my first salary was 2009, something like $200, I think, in Bucharest, which was not even enough to pay my rent. So, but I liked it very much. And it was pretty good in 2009. 2010, it was worse. They wouldn't even allow us to go out to do some reporting, just phone calls and trying to convince people to come to the studio because we didn't have money for gas and stuff. I mean, editorially, it was okay. But there was still this frustration that we didn't have enough resources to do better stories, just like the actual news line, and that was it. Yeah, this was radio. And television, it was some other... I wasn't a journalist, I was a producer for reality shows.
Sure.
It was an experiment. But I was under pressure in this reality show. I was censored, I couldn't do what I wanted.
Even do your own.
I had the executive producer non-stop on the phone telling me how to make the families look really bad.
Right.
Yeah.
So you were under constant pressure of not showing the truth.
Yeah,
right.
Well, I had this journalistic defect of trying to tell the true story.
That could be a problem.
It didn't fit to this reality show, of course. So. They kicked me out, which was very good, because then we started this.
Okay, so you're at a stage where you left the traditional press, pretty much upset with everyone, and you're thinking, I need to find a way of doing independent reporting that matters. How did you go about it?
Well, first of all, I wanted to tackle the position of the journalist. I wanted to be a journalist, but I didn't want journalist to mean that. So I wanted to change what journalism means and make it more like a liberal profession or as a craft, as a thing that you do in the search of truth and knowledge and information and for the public good. So I thought about these medieval blacksmiths or workers that had their house that had a pub. It was a mixture of private house and a public side in front in which they did their job. So I was fantasizing about a journalist that had a house which is partly open, so anyone could come in and see how you work, what you do. Okay, people can come in with stories, and it would be this transparency experiment. So people would start trusting journalists, and so we could do our job in a consistent manner to produce better stories, to have the story in the center of our activity and not this huge, complicated and corrupt structure that is a newspaper or a television. So that's why we called it Journalist's House. It was supposed to be a house for me. So when I was telling people about it, they told me they had two reactions, and one was that it can't be done, and it's kind of silly and stupid, but it's clearly impossible.
Is that your colleagues?
Everyone. Right. But I don't think anyone took it seriously, so they were just yeah, okay, yeah, right. But you know what would be cool about it? It would be cool if you had these events, you know, where journalists could meet up and have these conferences, maybe have investigative seminars, or maybe we could have an independent newsroom and where freelancers could come in and work on their stories for whoever they're working with. So people came up with ideas for this impossible thing, and I kind of went along with it and updated. I wrote it all down and I kept making sketches of what this institution would look like. And at one point, I found a house. So now we had a house. It was completely empty, no furniture, no nothing. And then came the protests in 2012. There was this, like, the first protest of our generation. We had some waves of protests in Romania in the 1990s after the revolution. And then this big break. And then in 2012, it started again. So I went out to do a regular report. I went to the protest. You might have seen
this
some.
This is the most recent images. One, right?
We can.
Can we show a little bit of it and talk about it briefly?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I went out on the street, and quiet Bucharest was on fire, and we had fights with the police, and I had a GoPro on my head, and I did this report.
What is it about?
The protest?
Yes.
Well, it started when the president made some nasty comments about the head of an institution that was highly regarded, one of the few institutions that are highly regarded in Romania. So people were very angry about it, and they were angry about the financial crisis. It was all just mixed together. They were angry at the political crisis.
Was that the police were intimidating you?
No, that was just some drunk guys asking why am I filming them trashing stuff. This was the side of the protesters. The police was nowhere to be seen. So this was the street being taken over by random people. So I came back to my house, and I wrote a report on it and published it the next day in the morning. I finished it in the morning, and I published it, and I went to sleep. And when I woke up, like, it was this, I had 20 missed calls, the Facebook was on fire, mails, I had the BBC and that wanted to do it. I was just woken up and I...
You needed an assistant?
I didn't know what was this all about, because I did several reports about events. It was just another day on the job. So I was really confused about this whole thing, and I had a really hard time managing it, because I was receiving all kinds of threats. Random people that were angry at me. If you write something that's visible, you're gonna have lots of people angry at you. I had people angry at me because I filmed the protesters. They were on the opinion that protesters shouldn't be filmed, that they should protest blindly or something. Other people had the opinion that I wanted to take the government down. So they were angry about that I was with this political party or the other political party. And I didn't respond to any of it, but there was one guy responding to most of it. It was this guy that I barely knew. And he was very angry of what was happening. So after...
So he was taking your side.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I couldn't be there. I had a knee surgery and I was in my bed and like, wow, what's going on?
Trench work.
So people started giving me this whole attention and they asked me why I'm writing this stuff and like, I'm a journalist, what
who
am
sent
I supposed
you?
To do?
Who
sent me and what do we want to do? So naturally I told them about this house that I just moved into and they said, oh great, this is gonna save the Romanian media. Okay, maybe we should get some furniture first. he came to visit me afterwards and we drank for a couple of days.
Weeks.
That's because of the success of BBC in Norway.
No, it drank because we are young people.
It was winter and cold.
And it was, yeah.
There was no heating in this house.
That makes sense.
And he told me, this was a good report and you did good, but how often does an event like this come up? What can you write about in Romania? And I was just on Facebook and there were people saying that in Burlad, that's a small Romanian town, people are organizing a fight against Chevron that wants to come and poison their water. It was this preposterous story that had sounded really weird. So doesn't this sound like a story that's worth following?
So being away from the traditional news agenda, you just followed your instinct.
Yeah, we went to see what was happening.
Yeah, we said, so why aren't we going there? It's a story. So we bought tickets and we left.
One year and a half later.
So that started.
Fracking Romania.
Yeah, we. So this turned out to be a year and a half investigation that took me all around Romania and to Pennsylvania to see the Chevron rigs already in operation and to talk with specialists from the US to share their experience. I talked to people that had environment problems and to people that were pulled from poverty by this. So 1.5 years later, we had this investigation. This is the English side. That was, it wasn't this report, it was a whole website. You can see in the left side, it's kind of chapters of the investigation. And it ended up getting lots of attention, and it proved that there are stories in Romania that can be covered and can be interesting, and we should definitely do it again.
Just for the record, following a massive number of protests and very good reporting, Chevron has left Romania and they're not fracking there anymore. Well done, guys.
Yeah, well, Chevron left Romania because they figured out that it's gonna be too expensive bribing anyone.
But there's so many governments coming and going, right?
It's just that the general idea
wasn't profitable.
Yeah, it just didn't make sense.
Actually, from Eastern Europe, because the areas in which they were seeking to exploit did not reveal the same resources as they had thought, so that's not quite the same thing.
Well, you make a calculation. You put the costs associated with it, and you put the money that you can get out. And from what I investigated, they factored this in, and they had a very large margin, so the royalties in Romania are very small compared to basically almost anywhere else in the world. So their margin would have been very large and would have compensated for the poor perspective in the geology. So the geology in Eastern Europe was very different from what they were used to in Pennsylvania and other places in the US. So basically, it just didn't work out.
So you mentioned that you received a lot of attention during your investigations. What sort of attention? Who approached you? And did you also try to collaborate back with traditional media? How does it work now?
Well, we tried lots of things. We didn't just come into this and said we're going to be this wholly independent center. First of all, we tried doing freelance work for newspapers in Romania. And turns out they don't want good stories in their papers. We made a couple of stories, like a complete story with photos, multimedia. And we sold them, we proposed to sell them for like $100 or something like that.
Per feature.
Per feature that was researched for months, that was, it was very hard to make. So we said, you know, give us $100 and we're gonna give you this, that's gonna bring in advertising revenue, and you're gonna make more money out of it. And prestige, and I don't know, you could win awards with this, and it's gonna be good, it really works out. And they said, no, we don't want it. Why? Some of them didn't fit their agenda.
Can you give me an example?
Well, this fracking story wasn't picked up by any channel that was supportive of US embassy and their interests or the direction they want for Romania.
Right.
Others just didn't want other reporters having a popular story on their website because it makes them look bad. You know, what do you mean we cannot do a good story? And we were, it quickly became clear that we are not going anywhere with this, so we just stopped trying that. But we tried the NGOs. We went to NGOs that had interesting media programs that promised us complete editorial independence, and that we could do research anything we liked. And it became clear that their programs, they had a direction and they had a set of rules that was that were no fit for journalism. So that didn't work out. We tried working with companies, but it turns out that you cannot write bad words in a story. You cannot write negative stuff or stuff that kind of puts them in a bad light. And we had lots of bad stuff and nasty stuff in our reporting because that's how life goes. So it was clear that that wasn't going to happen. So then we tried doing freelance stuff for international media. Also British media, for Channel 4, for BBC, for The Guardian, for Al Jazeera, for lots of outlets.
Did that work out?
It worked out better than the other stuff. I mean, financially, it was like we could work for a week and then spend 3 months doing whatever we liked, reporting on our own stories. But
they picked up your stories.
They picked up our stories, and we worked with their crews first as fixers and then kind of as reporters. But then we found out that international media is a little bit more complicated than we thought, and that the same systems that work so violently and nasty in the Romanian media are also true in an international context. It's just much more polite, much more, it respects most of the
much more regulated,
the letter of the journalistic ethics. But they still pulled the story in their direction. They had a clear interest in every story, and we just didn't like. I mean, we wanted our work to be.
So you felt they came in with a Western angled lens. Is that
It wasn't a cult, necessarily a culture, I think, a Western angle, but it was, for example, our stories on poor people in Romania. They came in the context of the scandal in the British media and the whole political drama that was manufactured around these poor people. And we had an instance when, from a story that we worked on, and that was very well put together, the message that the audience ended up having is that there are all these poor, drugged, violent Romanians that are coming to get them. And that's preposterous, because the poor, violent Romanians just want to stay and do their drugs and maybe do some stealing to get more drugs in their place. So we kind of had enough of that.
So just to start with that, briefly, don't forget your thought, but can you give me an example? This is what we've given them. This is the message of the article we've given them, and this is what they've actually published.
Well, you can't really do that, because this high-profile media works much more subtler than that. So you can't pinpoint this breach of ethics, that it was generally professionally done, but we felt that it didn't, the spirit of what was going on kind of ended up being mixed up in a lot of stuff and coming out with a different angle, with a different
maybe
meaning.
Maybe we should be like
more specific.
Yeah, specific.
Ștefan?
Can I be more specific?
Yeah, sure.
Please. And more loud.
Right. More loud.
Loud.
Yeah, so this very popular story on the Bruce Lee, King of the Sewers.
Yeah.
I'm sure everybody saw the story made by our colleague Radu Chornichuk. He worked like 2 or 3 months. I mean, he spent in the sewers with his very... really fucked up environment. Of course, the story, then he worked with Channel 4 on the same story. The story, the video story they came up with was really good, visually and journalistic wise in any way, but they showed it in a context. I mean, the actual story is great. But they put it in a show where they made some interviews and they just shifted the whole thing to something else.
It was
else.
Part of this politicized debate.
It was right before the elections last year.
Is it between poor Romanians are coming to Britain getting social benefits? Is that the angle?
Even worse.
That's the context.
Right.
But this was even worse. Those Romanian, these are the Romanians coming to get your benefits. That was the message.
So these,
that
okay.
So, yeah, and
did they explain how they have money to buy plane tickets and all that? Or are we going to see
but
them all over?
The story was that they build an underground empire. This is their life's work. They have like an underground castle. They don't want to leave. They want to stay there
the
because
Romanian
that's
society their is incapable of helping them or changing their situation, but I mean, of course.
Should we show a few minutes of it?
Mă cheamă Cătălina. Am făcut pe 14 aprilie, mă, ești pe
aia. Bă, ieșiți ca să din Cătălina, mă!
Nu să vă
vedeți.
Am cât de mă rog la sucat, nu mă dau. Mă rog la sucat, dar e bun.
In the sewer, this is how you get in. Yes, so basically they connected a network of sewers underground the Bucharest railway station, and they started renovating it, and they part of it is a hotel, part of it is like a club where you go and get high. And it's being fueled by theft, prostitution, human trafficking. There are minors being trafficked and lots of nasty stuff. And this whole thing works as a family. So they see themselves as a family. Family that has to do this and that in order to get by. And this guy, Bruce Lee, is like their father figure. It's more like a father figure, it's like a god figure that gives them all the bad things and all the good things. And they come to him with everything. And his story kind of explains what happened to everyone after the fall of communism. They are all orphans. So this is an orphanage. All of them are orphans that were thrown on the street after 89. And society didn't want them. Nobody wanted them. So they built their own society that works just like our society. Only it's more violent, more smells worse. And it's way, way sadder.
So it's a story about survival. It's a story about the failure of the system to integrate them as well. But it somehow was translated into an immigrant story over here.
It wasn't intentional by the reporters. It worked very well with the British reporters. But the way that the story entered the British mainstream media, with the Daily Mail pieces, it was just horrible to see. I mean, we lived this for months, and we knew all about this, and we were terrified, but by what it become, what it has become. So we decided to focus on doing our own stories and financing them directly from our readers, because all the other methods of financing did the job of financing, but they all had these nasty side effects that we just didn't want to go through again. So right now we are being financed exclusively by our readers. After each story we have a donate button, and every story is free and we don't have advertising, but people who like the story can make a donation. And we have these recurring donations that keep up the house and pay for our basic expenses.
Can the political parties fund you?
I guess individuals in the political parties can go on the website and click that button. But these are small donations. These are like 5-10 euros per month. So, and not one individual and not one group can have any significant influence on the editorial policy. We take into account the opinions of all the readers, and we get tips and we get lots of information from them. We work together on every story. Every story is an ongoing process that we publish on our Facebook page, and we get valuable information from them. But no one can impose an angle or something that we should do.
Right. Bit of a more indelicate question would be, how sustainable is this form of funding? How do you go about raising your funds from ethical sources, as it were, and how much does this stretch you and the stories that you may or may not be able to do with the resources you receive?
Well,
you can just pause it for a second.
This is by far the most the source of financing that we had. We were most comfortable with, that had the least side effects. almost zero, and also the hardest to achieve, because you need to have people that don't only read the story, they understand the story, they kind of go through this whole process that you went through, and then they realize that, you know, I have to be a part of this from now on. So it took some time to build a dedicated audience, and we don't get much money. We get like 1,000 euros a month now, which I don't know how many media organizations have this budget. This is definitely the way to go. It's the clearest, and then you can go with it forward with a clear conscience.
And how can your readers or your funders, supporters, can trust without knowing you that you are ethical and professional journalist?
Well, first of all, many of them know us because we make these events when we publish a big story. We have these parties at our house that start with a screening of a video or a talk about the story that we just published. We give them the print version of the story, and they can give us feedback in real life. So most of them really know us, or just
Bucharest-based.
Yeah. Yes. But other than that, it's...
I've never been to one of your parties.
Other than that, it's...
I'm not sure you'd like it. Pretty close to the sewer thing.
I can work undercover, it's no problem.
But, I don't know, they have to trust us, and once they start donating, they follow closely what we do. And when they see something that they find that they don't like, or that they find suspicious, they tell us about it right away. We have we receive these messages all the time, and we have this discussion. Mm-hmm. And they have, if we start doing nasty stuff,
like
publishing politically directed stories, like not doing anything.
Where's the money? Right?
Yeah.
Where's the money?
Doing poor journalism. If we do that, then they can make a difference in. I mean, they can withdraw their support, so we don't have any money left. So they have this very broad editorial control. If you are an asshole, you won't be able to live.
Can I perhaps say, I'll give you guys 500 euros, but I'd like you to investigate the Orthodox Church, for example, without necessarily saying what, but can they do that? Can they say, I'd like to put my money to investigate if this particular organization or institution that really, I think, is corrupt?
No.
Right.
I mean, they can tell that, but we don't do it, and we had these instances when people came and said, you know, I'm a contributor, I would like you to investigate that. And we said, you know, we don't do that. We work, right now we work on these stories, and we have these stories that we plan on working from now on. And if you like that, we are happy to have you as a contributor, but not, if not, just withdraw your contribution. But regardless of what he does with the contribution, we take into account his suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
We take it into account, as in we put it in the long list of subjects, and if at some point things connect in a good way, we might do it. But it has no direct link to him being...
So nobody can sell an agenda to you, in other words?
Well, no, they can... They try then, but it doesn't work. Because we do this because we really like doing these stories, and any interference would just spoil the fun, spoil the pleasure in finding out stuff. Even if you do a legitimate story, it still has a dirty beginning, and it doesn't feel right. So we won't do that.
You're Ștefan, now you don't have to do 3 stories a day. How long do you take for a story?
Oh my God. Well, I just came back from Syria like 3 weeks ago. And I wrote 3 paragraphs from the first draft. So yeah, I'm very slow. I like to take my time. Of course, I'm very slow because, first of all, I'm afraid of people, which is really bad in journalism. So I need time to be able to talk to someone. Now I'm better. Since we have...
Well, we've got 80 people in the room. I don't think you're that bad.
Yeah, that's why I'm only looking at you.
Well,
I'm
a
local. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it depends. It really depends on the story. What we always try to be quicker and better organized, and but we also had to all our experiences and experiments. We also figured, each of us figured for himself or herself how to work on a story, like how long you should spend with the source, what's the goal of your story. How can you achieve it quicker and with less risks or whatever? So, how do you structure your raw material? How do you write it? How do you publish it? So, I think each of us now has at least an idea about what's best for him. So, it will be quicker and quicker. The more stories we do, it will be better, I think.
And how do sources react now that you work for an independent platform?
So we need some background on the time that it takes to do a story. Because our stories have an anthropological background, have an strong anthropological side, as well as the investigative one. And in anthropology, you have to go in the field. That's the like the first law or the anthem. Anthropology, you go in the field and you stay there until you feel that everything outside has went inside you, and that you are a part of that community, and that you understand all the connections. So you go inside and you submerge yourself into it, and then you go on the outside and you have your experience to draw from, what you saw, what you felt, what you understood. And then you use that as the most valuable asset of your story, alongside all the other journalistic techniques. But the problem with that is that how can you figure out how much time you need to spend in a place? When are you prepared to move on to the next phase? When you have to draw the line, you say, you know, I thought about this for 6 months, that's enough. There's no recipe. You just feel it at one point, and we are nearing the point where you can feel that line better, and that makes us more efficient.
I guess having a budget might set a pace.
Yeah, but it also destroys the whole workflow. When we do stories that have a budget, that has a very negative impact on the stories. From my experience, the stories that I did with no budget, just scrambling my way through it because I really wanted to find out what was happening, that turned out the best.
Just wondering how sources react to you now when you say I didn't write for any specific paper or I don't come from this glamorous TV channel. How do they react? Do they want to talk to you more or less?
Well, I'm trying to
smile. We started from a very low point, like nobody wanted to talk to journalists in general, except when you're from, a big, flashy TV station and they think that they can get some money out of that coverage. So that was the motivation. They always ask us, if you're from ProTV, then they want to, they all join in front of the camera and start doing their dance or something. So we started from a very low point, and now We are starting to get recognized in institutions, they start knowing who we are, and it's basically a thing of fear. They know that if they don't want to talk with us and they give a shit response to a freedom of information request, that's gonna get on Facebook and all the country is gonna laugh at them. That's happened a couple of times, that those posts are very popular all the time. So they start being afraid of not answering questions, which is pretty okay.
This is like authority wise, but there's also civil society or whatever, any type of source that of course now it's much easier to approach. And I started creating a circle of sources from this poverty stories and stuff, that they really started trusting me, and we always have discussion about what this kind of journalism is and why it's important to show the story in this way, not in a TV manner or a mainstream media manner. And now it's much easier also because we have a somewhat well-established website that doesn't look like a casual blog or whatever.
It's
much easier than 3 years ago.
Are made by ourselves, and they took a long time to kind of develop into something that remotely looked professional.
But nevertheless, you've just won an award, right, recently, for your piece on migrant exodus. Would you like to talk about it a little bit? Just 80 people.
What do you want to know?
I want to know the kind of efforts involved in the piece, how long it took, your work there, and maybe just show a couple of minutes.
It took a very long time. 3 weeks I needed just to leave, because of course I needed money to leave. So I also have this other job, also in journalism, that provides me with some money. So I was doing a documentary for a rice project, but I really wanted to go to this refugee crisis to see it with my own eyes. So I first had to finish filming this documentary, and then I came back to Bucharest and took Matei, our colleague, and Thomas Campan, and went to Greece with some... We had money? I think, yeah, I had some money. No, we just bought some bus tickets and we went to Greece. Spent like 20 hours on a bus. Then spent some hours in the train station. We didn't see any refugees. We were in Thessaloniki, so we decided to go to Athens. Spent some other money, which we didn't really have at that point, on train tickets to go there, wasted another day, and then we found lots of refugees in Athens, fortunately. But it was really hard following them, because they had like all their economies or parents' money or whatever to throw on taxis and stuff, and it was really crazy. I mean, they just took out 200 euros and paid a driver, and the driver would take like 5 refugees, 200 euros each. So of course we didn't have 200 euros to pay for 50 kilometers drive or whatever. So it was really hard to follow some guys from A to B. But it was really, really cool experience. And yeah, you have to ask me some.
It was actually a pretty quick story to make, because it was a developing story and we had to publish it then. So it didn't take that much time, I think, like 2 or 3 weeks.
So this is you following them as they were trying to make their way?
Yeah, this is a footage from my colleague Matei. This is a group of Afghans that were crossing illegally through every border. I think this is Macedonia, maybe? They just came from Greece, and they were like really sportsmen trying to get to Germany or Sweden, whatever, as quick as possible without being caught by anyone, without registering anywhere. So they had a really fast
pace. No.
Era? Romania.
Romania?
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Matei just got stuck.
So this is then your right to come with us, because you're running across the border?
Some rogue villages close to the border.
Wait, why are you running?
They're running all the time, they were running.
They're not being followed by the customs?
No, they just want to get to Germany very quickly.
And they don't know if he's following them. And that was the whole idea, the mantra of the journey. Okay. Just run, run,
not
run.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
She took the journey with them all the way to...
We went from Athens to... I finished in Stuttgart. Matei went to Hamburg, I think.
He didn't go all the way with them, and I at one point he went with a different group, and I said, you know, why didn't you go along with the Afghan guys, because they were the most shady looking characters, and I mean, why didn't you go along with them? And he said, no, they were like kokalar. And I said, like this, they are shady guys, and I said, rednecks. And I said, what does that have to do with anything? That's a good thing. You just and I said, yeah. Well, they tried to take my shoes.
So Charles, that you cannot trust.
Yeah.
This can be seen on your website, right?
Yeah, it's part of the story. Okay. It's called 4,000 kilometers hurdles. I think it sounds better in Romanian.
We're going to take some questions from the public. Anyone would like to ask the two journalists? Yes, please. If you could please tell your name.
Yes, sure. I've followed you guys for a long time. My name is Raduca. My question is, how do you... you obviously you've got a community of people writing. How do you edit the stories? Do you cross-give them to each other? Is there one editor? How does that work?
We have a system that got developed along... it took a long time to develop, and we at one point we realized that, hey, what we're doing is a system of editing. And it goes... each story, each big story, has a community of editors. Like it could be 3 guys, it could be 10 guys. It's a collective editing process. And the story goes through lots of phases with different people with different skills. And usually it's being thrown around and...
people are crying. Some people.
Yeah, there's crying involved. And because everybody tries to be as sincere as possible and uncensored as possible. And the people that are crying because they just realized that they could have done a better story. And whatever. So...
you're not pulling anyone, are you?
Well, surprisingly, no. Because everyone knows that this is in the interest of the story. And we are all working together voluntarily to do this. Each one has his own story. We can focus on that. So in the end, we... the story is always better, by a long shot. I don't know, we should give it a name or something.
Gentlemen over here.
Hi, I'm David Webster. I'm wondering what distinction you draw between investigative journalism and advocacy journalism, what processes you have in place to stop this from one sliding into the other?
I think advocacy journalism, or... What?
It's promoting agenda rather than the truth.
It's when you fail at some point. So if you do your job right, you get involved in the story, you get a feel of it from the inside, so you get nearer to it, and you always have the danger of sliding into the other. And that's why we have this community editing, that stops this or tries to stop this from happening. We do it on a regular basis, especially now with our younger reporters that are in the, they have a hard time understanding what the, this border is, and the community takes care of that. We have like 10 experienced journalists that pitch in a story, pitch into this editing process, and all the sliding in one side or another usually gets thrown out. But what we shouldn't throw out is the anthropological angle that really makes the story better. When this shift to advocacy happens, it makes the story worse. So we are very determined to prevent it. It didn't always go smoothly, but we are getting better at it.
Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Maria. Just
wanted
to say I've been following you for a long time. Thank you very much, and I really respect your work and your courage, most of all. And I was wondering, how do you sort of treat the circumstances when you go in zones of conflict and the really amazing stories, but how do you prepare your process? What organizations do you liaise with, fixers, just to make sure that sort of stay alive? Because I know here in UK, there's a lot of, okay, when you work with The Guardian, with Al Jazeera, you can always just make a call and there'll be someone sort of picking you up and trying to make sure you get home. And how do you see this process and being an independent journalist works along that? Thank you.
Can you describe the process that you went through?
That's kind of stupid and crazy, of course. So what I did now when I went to Syria last month, I found some really cheap flights from Bucharest to Beirut. It was like 70 euros. And I was wondering, could I get in to Damascus from Lebanon? So I had to ask someone who was there. I asked this guy, Mircea Barbu, who was working in Adevărul, and he just came back from Syria in July or something.
Adevărul is a national paper?
Yeah. And he said, I have no idea, but look, I want to go to Syria. Do you want to come? And I said, yeah. Do you know how to get in? And he said, yeah. So I said, okay. So how much money do we need? He said, look, there's this scholarship. We can get some money from there. Just write me your CV and stuff, and we'll write the pitch and stuff. Okay, so we did that, and we got the money. So then I was really scared, because I didn't know what to do next. We had the money, we bought the tickets, but we didn't have any proper contacts, didn't have any gear, like protection gear, like bulletproof vest and whatever. So we just found some people, like some people who had some vests. And all the rest. And went to Syria. Yeah. But it was northeastern part of Syria, which is now under Kurdish control, and they have they're doing a really, really good job on securing the area. I mean, there's no bombing from the regime. The fights are pretty far away from the cities, main cities or towns. So, and everything journalists can do there is always under control of someone from the army or the provisional government of the area. But I don't know, how did you prepare when you went to Donetsk?
Yes.
And it was like, I think, worse than where I was in Syria.
Well, we had a general idea of what things might go wrong, and what things are out of our control. And we thought, how much risk are we willing to take? So we kind of set a limit to that, and said, we are going to take this much risk, and behind this line, we're going to do everything perfectly so that there won't be any risk, but there be going to be some factors, some variables that you cannot control, and we might get killed. We have this slim chance of getting killed, but we, you know, that's the job. But other than those risks that we cannot control, we're going to be safe. And then we went to Donetsk and crossed that line. because it's, yeah. And it turned out okay. Because we had the colleague, Lina Dovi, that I went with, that knew Russian and was very skilled in working in these Eastern conflict zones, like Transnistria, Russia, or that whole area. She was really good in managing the interactions with the soldiers. With the, but you know, we were documenting it. We were on the, next to the airport in Donetsk, and we were with a band of rebels that were hiding in a kitchen of a house that was boarded up, and. Almost all the houses were destroyed except this one, and we heard some laughing inside. We heard something, and we got nearer to it, and we just went inside, and we saw these weapons on the floor, and that's when I knew that maybe we're going too far because anyone can come out and they don't know who we are. But luckily, the soldiers were in the kitchen enjoying a nice coffee. In pitch dark, we only saw their cigarette butts, like five red points. And Lina came in with her wonderful voice and made the introduction. And they turned out to be really happy to see us. They didn't see like regular people for some time. And they showed us our the neighborhood and. They took us on this tour of the war scene, and they were telling us about how the cats are totally numb to the gunfights and the rockets and the shelling, and they were describing the sound of a shell. And if we hear that, we should like jump in a ditch or the nearest thing that we. We were writing down, taking pictures, okay, and then we heard it. And had a. I don't know, there was a movie, the Battle Mon Cor S'Arrête, the Beat My Heart Skip.
Yeah.
And then we continued our interview, we didn't say anything about it, just. We went into robot mode. I mean, we knew what we were supposed to do. We knew what we were doing, but we were just blank. It's.
Did you have a number you could call in case of an emergency?
We had contacts. We had an accreditation from the provisional government. We had. We knew people in Kiev, we were in contact with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, like, it's totally useless. The Romanian one. So we had all these things, but you know, they can only do it so far. So generally, the general framework is that you decide what kind of risk you want to take, and make sure that beyond that, you don't make anything stupid. So, I don't know, if someone would have died from this unstoppable thing, like a shell hitting you, that would be very tragic, unfortunate, but that you took that chance. But if you do anything stupid, if you don't know how to behave yourself, if you do anything unprofessional, and that gets you killed, that's the bad thing, in my opinion.
Yeah.
that's beyond the risk. That's beyond what you are by as a journalist. So that's the broad line that we try to draw. But as some of you know, the perils of freelance reporting in these war zones, as the most of the reporting in war zones is done by freelancers. And we have an extraordinary low amount of money, but in general, these freelancers that work in war zones are poorly paid, are poorly insured, they have pretty weak backing by the news outlets, because they cannot take the risks. They say, if you want to take that risk, we can pay you this, give you some support, but if anything happens. So yeah, it's generally bad. It's not just for us. It's a shitty job.
Hi, my name is Anna. I wanted to ask something about your days in the written press, in the traditional press, as it were, and also afterwards. So, do you know of any cases of whistleblowing that are notorious, or what would have happened to those people, because you mentioned how corrupt the written press is, and I guess maybe the media in general? And also, after you set up your own venue, as it were, did you have people coming to you trying to get you to cover this specific topic of corruption inside the world of media from a non-partisan angle?
So you mean whistleblowers from the press?
Yeah.
Well, he was one. He published an account of what happened to him on the website of an NGO that fights for freedom of the press. And there were others, but there is a problem with that. Because there are lots of journalists that did nasty stuff, that were part of the system, and they found themselves in a weak spot politically inside their news organizations. They were kicked out, or they... and then they realized that that the whole system is corrupt. They realized that they did it. I mean, they got money for writing articles. They avoided subjects. They imposed this editorial control on the investigative stories. And then they become these whistleblowers. So it's really hard of figuring things out in this world of media whistleblowing, because it's so murky. Nobody knows what to believe. It's very hard to trust someone. And I don't know, we have lots of... I mean, I know journalists that don't trust us. They admire our work, but don't trust us because you cannot trust anyone. Because no one is innocent in the Romanian media. And I don't know, maybe we were lucky to be too small to get in. Maybe we were lucky that when we got in, the financial crisis came, and that pushed us out. We don't know what would have happened if we were to grow professionally in a world that was full of money, like in 2000 and something, when money was pouring in the media. If you had a salary of 3,000 euros per month, how can you know in Romania that's some money? How do you know how you're going to react? So,
ever approached afterwards as an independent?
Yeah, I mean,
to talk about it more openly, as it were. So, did anyone try to get you?
We have a lot of friends working even in mainstream media who always complain to us. Like almost anybody working in media companies have stories, some story from their personal experience, but most of them never want to go public, or they just want to maybe leave the job and find something else. They don't want to put themselves into a risky position, not to be able to get hired in some other company or this kind of... So yeah, do we have any friends that didn't have any?
No, I don't think so. All of them went through stuff. But the weird thing is that it's not even true that you don't necessarily put your career in jeopardy. I mean, I got lots of job offers, even after saying this crazy stuff, and nothing really happened. That's the real thing. Nothing really bad happens when you talk. So it's all in their minds.
Unless you're somehow legally binded by a contract that can be used again.
Unless you're legally binded, but especially because if you have an abusive contract, you can take it to court and say that you were. That's not the main thing. The problem is if you took money, if you did something really bad, if you were part of the system, then you depend on the system to keep that hidden. So. It just doesn't happen, and we know lots of honest journalists that we think that they did everything right, but if the system works that way, you kind of have to behave in the same way.
A lady in
hat. Hi, I'm
Lisa.
I'm a journalist, and I was wondering how do you recruit new journalists? So since the first time I went on your website, the list of people contributors has grown up, so how do you get to know them, how do you recruit them, and what are your criteria to select them?
Well, first of all, the Romanian media landscape is not that big, so we mainly know each other, we know who does good reporting, and we meet up with lots of them, they come to our parties, they come to know us, and it's a gradual coming together. Usually, what happened in several cases was that they liked what we were doing, but weren't prepared to do something similar. But we became friends, and they stayed in our environment for a while. And at one point, they realized, you know what? I can really quit my job and do that. So, yeah. But from now on, that worked out fine for the most part. But the nasty effect was that, or the good effect, that this developed into a circle of friends. And that's nice. It's good to work with friends. It's good to have confidence in the people that you work with. But we that kind of limits
the
talent that you can grow in. So
the crying in the newsroom during this process.
Yeah. We'd like to see some new faces crying in our newsroom.
Okay. So you're welcome to try.
So from this spring, we're trying to make a relaunch of this whole house and concept. And we are going to formalize it a bit. The staying inside the house, because we have an actual house with actual rooms that are inhabited by journalists. So we have 5 rooms. And that they will be used for five spots for a journalistic residency program. So anyone who has a subject and has proven that they can do long form subject, they can do investigative stuff, they have the skills for it, but they didn't have the chance yet to really shine, they can pitch their story to us, and if they can visit us and see how we work along. And if all is okay, then they come in. They stay for a specific amount of time that they need. It's for like 6 months, 1 year, whatever that is. They get housing, food, equipment, expenses for documenting, and some pocket money, and the expertise of the others. So that should make this whole thing more open now that we start figuring out what it is that we're doing.
And the money would come still from people who donate?
We're gonna need to draw more money from crowdfunding. So we're gonna launch this with a new crowdfunding specifically for this. And I think it's doable. I think it's gonna happen.
Speaking of which, if you know anyone who'd like to sponsor an investigative scholarship, you're welcome to spill the beans and bring it up to their street.
Yeah, I have a question just about what you said with new journalists. Do you have any sort of idea of how you can influence or improve what's happening at school? Because you said, oh, my teacher told me I'm a whatever, factory worker. Don't you think that's sort of what's creating new journalists? If somebody graduates tomorrow and shows up at your door, will you take them on?
The plan is to put this residency system in place. And then we need a flow of people that can go through this, that are prepared to go through this, because you cannot take them from step zero. You don't take people from the street, you take journalists, young journalists that can do that. So at one point we're gonna need to go to the Faculty of Journalism and kind of draw them in. We thought about a parallel process, kind of a student boot camp or something, so we can prepare them for the time that they can either go into a residency at our place, or we can do something on their own, or they can get hired in a good place, because we start having good places in Romanian journalism, good media, I mean decent media companies, not top notch, but really decent, a place where you can really get information, not just propaganda. So we're gonna do this student program, but it's gonna take some time for us to go there, because we are just reporters, and we want to report, and we found ourselves constantly in need of making up the system in which we can report freely, and that we slowly realized that this freedom is more and more complicated than we initially thought. So we're trying to balance it, but it's gonna happen.
Are there any questions? Yes. What do you read in terms of news? Do you read everything? Do you not read things? Do you look for new things to read? But what journalism do you consume?
Well, most of us are compulsive news readers, like constantly scrolling on Facebook and New York Times. And we have a couple of websites that in Romania media that we follow. Some of them are pretty good, some of them are, the angle is part of the information, so you kind of draw some conclusions from the way that they report and stuff. So basically anything. We have a couple of people on Facebook that are a really good source of news, and I think one of them is in this room. Everyone has developed a kind of his own system of staying in touch with reality.
I guess a related question would be, if you know a certain policy regarding, say, mining or regarding fracking might come in 6 months' time, do you prepare in advance something to counteract or to inform the people on that particular strand?
Well, if we come, we don't generate the news. We do long-form feature stories, but if we work on a story, like when I was working on a fracking story, I was posting news on Facebook, because I had first-hand access to information, and so you become a news source for the article that we're documenting. So if I was writing about this mining thing and I found out about this, I would be a news source for that particular subject. And if it, I don't write about it, but I realize that I'm going to be interested in it, I pick up on the story as well. But there is only so much you can cover without getting...
How big is your team? How big is your team?
Well, generally I start with a very specific event that piques my interest. I then identify the general theme, the part of society that that event fits into, and I start documenting all of it, start getting a general understanding of it that might be philosophical, administrative, scientific, whatever it might be, and then slowly come back to that small thing that piqued your interest and put it into context. So this small thing, then the big thing, and then this medium rare.
Are there any other questions? Yes.
And then, did you have any, like, any expectations when you went more for the seaside this summer? Or it was like a working holiday or
Expectations and
yeah, when you went, did you know what you want to do for sure, or it was just walk and see what happens?
Well, the story in question was we started this summer, me and the filmmaker friend decided that we want to walk by foot on all the Romanian seaside. That's 250 kilometers. And basically we had this, it was a thing that I wanted to do for a long time. And I put it into a journalistic context, thinking that the Romanian seaside is split into two very different areas. A very economically active touristic area in the south, and a basically deserted, wild and unknown area in the north. But it was this one thing. So we wanted to bring these two worlds together. That's how we started, and then we just picked up the stories as we went. We met people, we saw things, and that's, things go always.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Where are you at the moment, and what should we expect from you in the future?
Well, I'm working on a follow-up story on the earthquake documentary that I did about the buildings that are going to collapse in Bucharest. Bucharest is in a seismic area, and when the earthquake comes, an estimated 10,000 people are expected to die. Because we have lots of buildings that we know for sure, I mean our architects tell us it's gonna happen, that they're gonna collapse and the people are gonna die. Lots of them have clubs, cinemas, and all kinds of venues, so it could be nastier if it's in a Friday night. So I'm doing a follow-up on that, starting with the recent events in Romania. We had a big fire that started a big debate on building safety and general safety. I'm working on that. I'm working on a big feature story on Romanian protests and activism from 2012 to now. I'm trying to put it in a sociological context. Now that after the fire, we had this street movement that took down the government, and it became clear that there is a line going through all these movements, that we had all these protests that happened, and it has a big sociological significance, and it tells us a lot about the new generation that is coming up in Romania. So I started working on that, and I don't know, I have I think 5 subjects that I'm working on right now, and I'm really bad.
He's actually doing this story about the seaside. But
yeah, I was doing the story about the seaside. I was working on that when I got sidetracked by this one event. And generally we're trying to balance staying focused on the story with staying in a flow, in a social flow, so you can have, you can be of use to society. And I have a follow-up answer. Is there such a thing as a follow-up answer? to the answer about, to the question about advocacy, that we get lots of times in Romania, because Romanians have this thing with objectivity. The only thing all Romanians know about a journalist is that he has to be objective. And I wondered for a long time what does that mean for them, and I started researching what objectivity means to most Romanians, and I found out that what they meant by objectivity was this language. The language of the news, of the news agency specifically, or at the news anchor. So you would have these televisions that were telling these preposterous stories about their owners that were being prosecuted, And they were doing that in a very serious tone, with heavy words, with a very standardized phrasing, and people saw that as being objective. And in the beginning, at least, when people didn't, now we have lots of people that know us in perspective and know how we approach stories and don't jump to conclusions. But in the beginning, we had this huge problem with anything anthropological. I have this thing with anthropology. I started a master's in anthropology that I didn't finish because I went on the field all the time. So basically what we're trying to do is balance a thorough understanding of a social and psychological process with fair reporting on a matter. So so the big story would be it have a fair and honest angle. So for example, on the fracking story, that story started, I told you how we came upon the story. It started from the people in that village. And it grew until we got to the whole energy system of the world, and I researched that as well.
This phone of God, that's the title of the story. Don't worry in terms of time. Well, two more questions maybe, and then maybe we should...
So in that particular case, we started with the people, and ended up telling this story of how the world works, and what energy actually means, and how it functions, how this energy system functions, and how shale gas came into this as a solution, and why is it here? We're trying to kind of change the meaning of these terms, and put an emphasis on fairness, on transparency, and then...
Can I have a follow-up on your follow-up and also answer your question about stories up next? Because yesterday we just came out of the airport and I saw all the CCTV, and I just remembered I started a story about surveillance last year. But it's really hard in Romania to actually find out anything because there's no transparency and all these very good instruments that exist to pick up public information from the government or whatever never work. So I remembered about this surveillance stuff, and we actually set up an interview with someone from Scotland Yard. So we're gonna do some advocacy when we go back, because I just wrote an email and the guy responded in less than an hour and set up an interview and a meeting in Scotland Yard, and he will show us how this thing works, which I wasn't able to do in like 3 months in Bucharest. So we're gonna use this to put this on.
Well, I think every journalist rightly advocates for freedom of the press and transparency. That's no question, that's on the table. But I think a better example, and I'm through with this objectivity nightmare with this. He started writing this story about police abuse that culminated in a poor guy getting beat up until he died. So it was a murder by policemen. On the course of this investigation, he ended up being beaten by the police himself as he was filming the policeman beating another guy on the street. So this is,
do you have to see this again?
Yeah, so he was filming this, and then the policeman took him, got him into the station, and beat him up too.
This is not the guy who died, right?
No.
Somebody else beaten by the police while being arrested.
This is undercover policeman.
He's not undercover, he just doesn't wear a uniform. He's a boss. so he doesn't have to wear armor.
So the police kicking the journalist.
So that they got him into the police station and we could beat him up some more. And we had, this was a much greater scandal than the guy getting killed. So he just got some spit and beaten a bit. But we got responses from RCC, from there was this whole international outcry on beating a journalist. And then we were all wondering at the house, how is he gonna report on this if he got beat up himself? How is he gonna report on this affair? So he finished the story. And after some time, actually a week or so, the... Can I say this?
What?
The killer contacted him.
Oh, okay.
And told and told him that, you know, I thought about it and I read the story and I saw that you were the only guy that, you know, had a fair and decent reporting on this, and I want to talk to you. I want to talk to you at this point. So at that point I was like, yeah, he did it. He reported with empathy and with understanding, not finding excuses, but drawing the context in which that happened. Because those policemen are not bad people in themselves. They came to this in a specific context. And this context is gonna churn out lots more bad policemen and bad people and bad citizens, and the crooked system really generates crooked people. So so yeah, that's the weird and the sad and the funny way that we look at this whole thing with objectivity, transparency, and drugs.
I think we need a drink.
Yeah.
So thank you everyone for your attention. The journalists are going to be here. Please approach them with questions, funding, and everything else. Thank you very much for being here. Let's have a drink.
Let me thank you.
A drink, we'll have to work for it. So to start with, if you want to support the work of Casa Jurnalistului, as you've heard, they solely rely on the support coming from their subscribers, from their readers. So you can donate on their page directly. Have a look on the handouts that you have, and you have there more details about how to support them. I would like to thank Krina, Vlad, and Ștefan for accepting our invitation this evening. And you for coming, thank you very much. If you would be kind to fold your chairs and put them to a side, after we're going to clear the space, we're going to have some wine and some pretzels courtesy of Belly Twist. Thank you very much.